through this firsthand. Tell us your experience, and do you think the law failed you, or is it the systems that were against you on this?
Thank you again for having me this morning. Actually, I believe, and it is well that we have the honorable member sponsoring the whistleblower's bill, because what ideally happens, or the script, the way it is scripted, is like when you whistleblow, it is reduced to an employer-employee relationship. So they don't want to bring in the aspect of whistleblowing. So the victimization and everything, it boils down to an employer-employee relationship. So the law as it is not adequate enough to cover for people who have whistleblown.
Yeah.
Because the Bribery Act, for instance, it's only a section, Section 62, I think. It's only that one that covers, and it only covers the bribery aspect, not the corruption or whistleblowing aspect of it. So I believe, and I think Honorable Kasalu, before their term ends, I believe she will sail the bill through so that it is protected, because you know corruption has a very big impact, on, not only on the economy, but on also on our well-being.
Yeah. Tell me your experience right after you blew the whistle on this whole corruption case at the Mara. We, in fact, call it the Mara heist with the Waiga Maura. How did your life turn?
Well, it has the positives and the negatives. And I choose to dwell on the positives. Because the negatives mainly were the name calling, outright blackmail, and character assassination. But on the positive side, after I got fired, ESPAC, which is my professional body, and TI Kenya, and Amnesty International Kenya, they came together and actually made me a consultant for the three bodies.
Yeah.
We are trying to set up what we call a public defenders fund, so that it takes care of those that are most vulnerable. Because in this situation, most employers want to make you feel as vulnerable as possible. And in most cases, is to cow you down, because now you are fired, but you are still testifying before people who did whatever they did. So what we thought, the three bodies, is we can set up a fund to take care before, of course, before the whistleblower's bill come or becomes law, we can take care of those who choose to whistleblow, because I know there are so many, and it is not only accountants.
Yeah.
I only happen to be an accountant, and you remember I was not alone. So we want people who whistleblow, and they have the technical know-how of how the whole thing rolls down. So since I was fired, that is what I have been up to. We've been setting up a public defenders fund, and I hope we will come to launch it here, and so that we take care of as many people of goodwill, because this is a public interest thing, as many people of goodwill as possible.
But looking back, would you still, in hindsight, and they say hindsight is 2020, having gone through everything that you went through, would you still do the exact same thing that you did, and would you advise others to do it, considering that at least you have someone who came to your rescue, but there are those who they whistleblow and nothing happens, and they're fired, nobody cares, nobody cares where you went.
Actually, what I would say, whatever it is that we did, we were a team of us, it's not out of the ordinary. Actually, in our most of our core values as organizations, we always cite integrity, confidentiality, blah, blah, all those things. But now when it comes to the real deal, that's where now people like don't want to go into. But for me, I've always insisted, I was doing my work, I was just upholding my professional code of conduct and upholding the organizational values of integrity.
Which explanations were you given for being fired?
I was told maybe it was cyberbullying. So it was basically cyberbullying, and then broken down into 9 points. So that was it.